Hi, this is Randall Schwartz, host of Floss Weekly. This week, Aaron Newcomb joins me. We're going to be talking about crisis cleanup, the coordination software that helps all the volunteers work together and on a same plan. You're not going to want to miss this, so stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Floss Weekly is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Floss Weekly with Randall Schwartz and Aaron Newcomb, episode 327, recorded March 4th, 2015, Crisis Cleanup. It's time for Floss Weekly, the show about free, libre, open-source software. I am your host, Randall Schwartz, Merlin at StoneAge.com, bringing you each week the movers, the shakers, the big projects, little projects, projects you may be using every day and not aware of it, projects you might not have ever heard of and now want to find out more about, which is lucky because that's the kind of project we have this week as well, something you may not have heard of. But first, let me bring on my wonderful and talented co-host, Aaron Newcomb. Aaron, welcome back to the show.
Hey, Randall, good to be here.
Great, and it looks like you're in the brick house?
I'm in the brick house. I've got the lovely window behind me. I'm in the living room set here. It's very nice.
I thought that was a halo.
That's there too. I mean, I know it's hard to see me with the brightness of my halo because I am such an angel, but
indeed.
No, it's good to be here again. It's been a few weeks anyway.
Yeah, and for me, I'm in my home in Silicon Rainforest, and unfortunately, this is the random day, one out of every 30, when it actually has the sun in the morning. So if you're watching the video, I'm trying to get between the little spots on my face and the big spot on my face, and hopefully that'll disappear in about another half hour or so. Anyway, so we have a wonderful and very interesting project on today, and it was arranged all within the last few days. Took a lot of scrambling to get everything in place, but I'm glad I got them on. This is, we're going to be introducing in a few moments, Aaron Titus, who's going to speak to us about Crisis Cleanup, which is both an organization that makes sure that cleanup coordination happens when a crisis happens, like a major hurricane or a flood or something like that, and it's also an organization that's producing the software to make this all happen. And, you know, the more I read about them, the more interested I became in what they're actually doing and the sort of fill-in gap that's happening here, because apparently there wasn't just kind of good software around. I'm going to ask Aaron about that in a few minutes, to actually do this kind of coordination. And here, open source people to the rescue have brought together a number of technologies to make it possible for the volunteers to organize with the NGOs, to organize with and to get in touch with the people who need the most help, which apparently is a fairly difficult thing because phone lines are down and people, ask for things from multiple organizations, which is a bit of annoying and things like that. So I'm really excited to have them on today. What do you know about this, Aaron Newcomb?
Next to nothing, actually. I mean, I've heard of it just through the grapevine and talking to other people, but I've never really looked into it. So I'm really interested to find out exactly how this works. I mean, my assumption is that the open source part of this really helps in order to iterate quickly, be able to pull different pieces in when you need to, because there's every crisis situation is going to be a little different. So I would imagine that the open source side of this is actually very beneficial for this type of software, but I have no idea. So I'm looking forward to asking our guest, the other Aaron, see what he says.
Yes. And also I just want to read the sort of the tagline, on the top of their homepage here. 11,000 people helped, 17 disasters, 4 countries, 230 plus organizations, 40,000 plus volunteers. But the thing that got me was $26 million of impact. So again, this is going to be one of those shows where open source is being used to improve humanity and not just make a buck or give you a web page. So really looking forward to bring for the show today. So without further ado, let's go ahead and bring on Aaron Titus. Aaron, welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you for having me. Happy to be here.
Great. And where are you speaking to us from?
I'm in Boulder, Colorado. Lived until recently in New Jersey, and now I'm in Boulder.
So you got to upgrade then, you're saying?
That's right. I love New Jersey. New Jersey is a wonderful place.
Okay. So I gave what I thought the view of crisis cleanup was about, but you're the project director, so you give us the elevator pitch first. What's it all about?
So after a disaster, voluntary organizations, voluntary organizations like the Red Cross and the Baptists and the Mormons and the Lutherans and the Catholics all converge on the field to help survivors who need help. And sometimes that means mucking out basements or cleaning up debris or doing long-term recovery. And they duplicate efforts. Nobody can see the entire field at once. It's a lot like you're playing a game of soccer with a whole bunch of teammates, but everybody has a box over their heads and nobody can see what any of their other teammates are doing. So there's an organization or a movement called VOAD, Voluntary Organizations Active in Disasters. It's a regrettably forgettable name that they didn't obviously talk to a marketing person before they chose it. But the VOAD community is, they get together and then they're supposed to coordinate, collaborate, and communicate. But the coordination, collaboration, and communication does not happen very naturally. And so that's why we created Crisis Cleanup, was to help that coordination to occur.
And so what initiated that, and how did you initially become involved?
So I was the Mormon Helping Hands VOAD representative in New Jersey for some of Irene, Hurricane Irene, and then Hurricane Sandy. And people have asked me, so what was your aha moment? And there was no aha moment. It was more like an uh-oh moment. I had 30,000 volunteers. And we had to get them to several thousand locations across a 500-mile arc in three different states in about 8 weeks. And there is absolutely no way that a single person can do that or coordinate that. And so I knew I had to allow organizations and the local teams to coordinate themselves. So the project just kind of it's Craigslist. It's a Craigslist philosophy in many respects. Any organization that knows of a need puts the information in the system, and then any organization that has capacity will then claim it and then go and help people as they have capacity. It seemed like a very straightforward idea to me, and I kept expecting somebody to say, oh, yeah, these folks over here, they've already done that. And then I was going to say, oh, thank you very much. Here's the project. Good on you. But after 6 months of Hurricane Sandy cleanup, it became apparent that nobody really had ever done that before.
Well, you know, that surprises me, because it I sort of imagined that it would be something that is a repeatedly solved problem, especially since the age of computers. Are you saying there's not like coordination software that already does this?
So in the in the disaster recovery space, first of all, the disaster recovery industry isn't one industry. It's like 80 industries. None of them talk to one another, and only about five of them really consider themselves disaster industry. So that's one thing. Number two is that these organizations mimic their government brethren and adopt a command and control structure to command and control mindset. The problem is that the V in VOAD, voluntary, means you're not the boss of me. And so there are plenty of other software, work order management software solutions out there. Some are just tacked together and informal, and some are quite formal. But they all have one thing in common. They adopt a command and control mentality. You come into my house, you do things my way, you report to me, and if you're lucky, I might give you some credit. Now, when you're a voluntary organization, a nonprofit, and you have to demonstrate your value and qualify for the next grant, reporting up the line that doesn't really exist doesn't work very well. So there are natural, I guess, market barriers to collaboration and communication that make it unlikely. I mean, one thing, the tagline for VOAD is communication, collaboration, coordination, and cooperation. It's the four C's. And I tell people, if the four C's came naturally, we wouldn't have to have an organization devoted full time to their promotion. And I wish they did. With Crisis Cleanup, I think the reason that it works is that by participating as an organization, you always get more than you give. And so it's a little bit disruptive. It's very disruptive to the command and control structure, but you get better visibility as to what's going on. And so some of the organizations want to feel like they're in charge, and they can log into Crisis Cleanup and see everything that's going on and sit in their little lair and go, wah ha ha, I'm in charge. And if I need to feed that neurosis, that's okay. But Crisis Cleanup fundamentally does not adopt a hierarchical accountability model. Instead, it adopts a collaborative accountability model, or more of a horizontal accountability. It's the same kind of accountability that you get when you play on a team. If you're on a soccer team and one of your teammates doesn't pull his weight, collaborative accountability ensues. And that's the kind of accountability that happens in the voluntary space.
Great. So that's you've described pretty well the problem space. So how does crisis cleanup, the software, help solve that? What are we seeing when we're in it, and what does it allow us to do? Is say, like the various roles, like a person reporting trouble, a person's offering coordination, a person's offering actual volunteer services. How do they interact with this software, and what do they get from that?
Yeah. So crisis cleanup serves the people who serve survivors. So crisis cleanup doesn't interact directly with the public, and there are some practical reasons for that. Number one, I have no funding, and it's just me, and I cannot manage 500,000 people all hitting my website. Number two, anytime that you interact directly with the public, you become accountable to the public. And crisis cleanup isn't really designed to provide that type of instant feedback, primarily because I cannot authenticate the public. So how do I know that you are you and not the estranged ex-husband for whom there's a restraining order against you? And so without that ability to authenticate, what I'm doing is I'm supporting the organizations that are interacting directly with survivors who are on the ground. So let's say that you have a local St. Mary's church or something, and they are at ground zero of the disaster. They don't have any capacity to help, but everybody's coming to them and asking for help. Well, I want you in crisis cleanup, because as you enter the information into crisis cleanup, instantly a little icon appears on the map, and then volunteers from some other organization sitting on a curb somewhere see that work order pop up on a map. They can then claim it, contact the owner, and then go straight to work. Now, you mentioned the $26 million. The $26 million number is actually pretty low, but I'll tell you how I came up with it. I was thinking to myself one day, if I could show $1 million of impact, that would be so cool. And that $26 million number comes from improved efficiencies alone. So if after Hurricane Irene, we'd have 1,000 volunteers. You drive a half hour to some field command center. We wait an hour and a half to get checked in. And then after you get checked in, you get your paper work orders. You drive 45 minutes to your assigned location, and you start working. And I'm looking around at these 1,000 volunteers all waiting to get checked in, which checking in an hour and a half is really good, by the way. But still, I abhor inefficiency. So everybody pulls out their phones and they're playing Angry Birds. And I'm thinking to myself that this is a wasted data entry opportunity. I could have you all checked in 30 seconds with your work orders and on your way. So once Hurricane Sandy rolled around, I had been kind of thinking and planning how to solve some of those problems. And during Hurricane Sandy, I remember one Saturday in particular, we had 4,400 volunteers out in the field that week. And I was at a field command center, and it was a ghost town because everybody had logged into the system, found a group of work orders that they wanted to work on. They claimed them. They then called the homeowners directly, arranged a time to go. And instead of driving a half hour out of their way, checking in for an hour and a half, and then 45 minutes back to their work orders, they were able to drive directly to their site. And all of that time that was wasted in travel and management was reinvested directly into survivors. And once I added that up, those hours, the commercial value to the money that we saved the survivors was $26 million. And that was only for my organization. And there were 120 organizations that participated in Hurricane Sandy with crisis cleanup.
So I've got a couple questions. And unfortunately, this is so interesting, they may not be related so much to the open source aspect of that. I know we're going to get there, but I'm just curious, like, since there's usually in disaster, you have other organizing entities. I'm thinking like Red Cross or government entities. What is their reaction? Does this actually help what they're doing or hinder or get in the way? Have you had any feedback from them on how this fits in with their normal response activities?
Well, so that's a really good question, because most people think, when you think disasters, you think Red Cross and you think government. Well, it turns out that government and Red Cross do an incredibly vital role, play incredibly vital roles, but they're very limited in what they do. So the Red Cross does mass care and first aid, sheltering, that kind of a thing. But they don't go into basements and help muck out all of the mud that came in because of the flood. Or after a fire, they don't have giant machines that go and sift the ash. That's actually something Samaritan's Purse does. They're really good at it. Every organization has a niche, a specialty. The Baptists, for example, have these mobile kitchens that will turn out 20 and 30,000 hot meals per day. And they just do that as a part of their ministry. So the faith-based community is also a really big. Salvation Army. I mean, you know, there are hundreds of these organizations. So to answer your question, the FEMA, the Red Cross, love it because it helps them. It helps them, or not corral the cats so much. It helps the cats kind of corral themselves. And so there's more transparency within the community. There's a better idea of how many people need help and where they need help. Whereas before, the coordination would occur with Excel spreadsheets flying around in emails and Google Docs, to which, you know, three organizations have access at the most. And so there was no comprehensive picture whatsoever as to what was going on.
Mm-hmm. The other question I had is, in a disaster, I mean, we just went through, we had an earthquake up here near this area about, was it 8 months ago or so, or 6 months ago? It was last fall. And, you know, it was a pretty big deal. And I'm just kind of curious, like, when something like that happens and power lines go down and things like that, I mean, what are the avenues to interact with this? Since you've got to imagine that their communication lines are going to be disrupted, you know, you're not going to be able to get to the internet. Maybe you might have cellular service, you might not. How do I interact with this? Is it for volunteers on the ground in one of those situations, or is it really for volunteer organizations that are far enough away from the disaster that they have access to the internet or to their cell phones to interact with the service?
So that is exactly the right question to ask, and I didn't even plant it. The crisis cleanup is for the team leaders and the team leaders on the ground and the volunteers on the ground who are interacting directly with survivors. That's who this is designed for. Now, your point about, well, what happens when you don't have communications? Practically speaking, what we've found is that the voluntary organizations only begin the cleanup after the guns and the hoses roll up and the guys with the guns leave. And that's when things open up. And that doesn't really begin until about 72 hours after the disaster at the earliest, and it's often about a week. During most disasters, there is enough infrastructure still in place after 72 hours or a week that you can make crisis cleanup work. You may not have internet connectivity precisely on location, but you can drive 5 miles to somewhere that does. Now, in the event that we have World War III or Armageddon and the world as we know it has ended, well, you're not going to be thinking about crisis cleanup anyway, and we have larger problems. But what we found is that, for all practical purposes, it is useful once the voluntary agencies begin to spin up and deploy.
Interesting. So I know that, you know, on several disasters, I have contacted like Samaritan's Purse and other organizations to say, hey, can I help? You know, I'm willing to drive or fly somewhere and, you know, help clean up or something like that. And they always, the answer to me on the couple of attempts that I've made to do that has been, you know, we'll take your name, we'll let you know. You know, we're trying to work with local governments or whatever to see what we need, and if we need you, we'll let you know or something like
that.
I mean, it sounds like this is really. And I think the reason that they say that is because the coordination is so difficult, and it sounds like this may be an avenue to get more people where they're needed and not in the way very quickly, as opposed to trying to rely on small charitable organizations or government organizations that are too busy worrying about, you know, shoring up the levees to take a look at this. I mean, it sounds really spectacular.
So some of the things that you talked about, It's called the Spontaneous Unaffiliated Volunteer Problem, SUV, Spontaneous Unaffiliated Volunteers. And in after disasters, the SUV problem is huge. It is so, so difficult to be able to use SUVs. One of the reasons is you may not just be able to coordinate, right? There's just too much going on, and something like crisis cleanup might be able to help you know where the needs are and deploy. But in order to use a volunteer, you need two things. You need a trust framework, and then you also need a shared work culture. So what I mean by a trust framework is when I'm in somebody's basement, the reason that I know that this old lady who I'm helping is not going to get robbed is because Brother Jones, who I'm working next to, I've gone to church with him for the last 10 years, and I know and I trust him. There's a trusted relationship. If you're a volunteer with AmeriCorps, that trust framework occurs or is created with a background check, for example. So that's the first thing you need. The second thing you need is a shared work culture. If you were to go to the Red Cross after a disaster and say, I want to help with sheltering, the first thing they'll ask is, okay, are you trained for sheltering? And if you say no, they'll say, well, I'm sorry, sheltering is something you can't just do. You know what? You need to know how to shelter the pedophiles and the gang members who are a member of the other gang and the opposing gang. And yeah, all of those things, they all need shelter too, and you need to understand how to deal with that. Unfortunately, there's no app for that. I can't write an app that will develop a trust framework and a shared work culture ahead of time, the training and I'll give you an example. So with my organization, we had a strategic partnership with another organization that does wonderful, wonderful work. Now, with my volunteers, our work ethic and culture was show up at 8 a.m., we work all day until it's done, and if it's not done, we come back in the morning, and you just work until it's done. This other organization, we blended our teams, and the work ethic or the work culture was slightly different. At 2 p.m., they all said, well, okay, my shift's over, and then they took off. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. Everybody needs to go home sometime, but it was incredibly disruptive for the team structure. And mixing those, getting those right is very important. So that's what probably that's what you're experiencing with directly after disaster. If you want to help with a disaster, you need to get involved ahead of time.
Well, what kind of, let's start to maybe turn this a little bit more towards the open source discussion, because I do want to find out, you know, I raised the question at the beginning of the show. I'm kind of curious why the open source aspect is even mentioned here. I mean, what good does it bring to the equation? Because you mentioned open source right up front in terms of the components that go into this. So why open source? What benefit does it bring to this type of application?
So there's a couple of reasons that we talk about it as being open source. Number one, it is. But why is that important? Number one, it brings a trust, I think, to the equation. I mean, you and I both know what open source actually means. I think there's a broader and perhaps somewhat there's a broader understanding. When most people hear about open source, they think, oh, it's free and you're not making any money off of it, which does happen to be true in this circumstance. But it signals to the voluntary space that I'm not just some other vendor who is trying to make a buck. You know, that this really is just a labor of love for me, and I'm not going to hold you hostage. It provides a level of assurance that if I decided one day that this is just, I'm going to sell out and become a bad person, they could take the code and deploy it themselves and keep on, you know, keep on with business as usual. So there's that aspect to it. I think with open source, it helps with its adoption internationally. Now, I'm an attorney by trade. I specialize in information privacy law. And one thing that is important to me is privacy, and I can talk to you about some of the controls that we have, particularly with data minimization. But every country has their own laws and their own recovery cultures. And when it comes time to deploy this in India or in Canada or in Australia, I want to make sure that we're not, that we're working on different implementations. And so the ability, the fact that it's open source means that somebody, some organization can take it and then just deploy it. And then we'll have international partners. So I'm working with a guy named Mark Tregalis. Oh, by the way, now would be a good time to mention all of the wonderful people that we're working with who have made this possible. There's Mark Tregalis down in Australia. He runs crisis cleanup in Australia. But the folks who really have made this work, Andy Gimma out of New York, is that my co-project manager and the primary programmer for this. A guy named Chris Wood out of the UK, I think he's currently in Silicon Valley for the next couple of months, has been absolutely essential to making crisis cleanup work. And then the Jeremy Pack, he's a Google employee in Silicon Valley, and he and Bruce Christensen built the first version of crisis cleanup. And then Think So is a design firm. They developed our pin logos. Carissa Phelps did our pins. As you might imagine, there's a saying in disaster recovery that once you've seen one disaster, you've seen that disaster. Everything is different, and so we need different icons to indicate different types of disasters. So Carissa has done all of that. And we've had about 48 other programmers who have worked on this, on the project at one point or another. So very heavily in debt to them.
So internationalization is key in terms of choosing open source, because I guess there's the marketing term would be low barrier to entry or something like that, where no matter what country you're from, you can kind of pick this up and run with it without worrying about some sort of proprietary software or anything getting in the way of a country's ability to use the software. So that's interesting. I'm wondering also, is there a need, as this has been developed, is there a need for pulling in different types of functionality and modules quickly? And in terms of developing, is the iterative speed of putting something like this together, are you ever responding to somebody that says, oh, you want to use this and, you know, we're in the 11th hour and we need to interface with such and such technology to make this work? I mean, do you ever get those requests? Is that another reason potentially to use open source as opposed to proprietary technology?
So yes, we do get those requests. Some of them we can accommodate and some of them we can't. Our next major, we're on version about, I'd say 2.8. So our next major version release will, we're maturing our data model right now. Our data model is not very mature. And so once we mature that data model, we're building the foundation to create APIs. Everybody would love an API. I would like it. I'd like to give you an API too. And that's certainly on the horizon. But we haven't built that one yet. So the answer to your question is yes. And we have been, it is extremely important and nice to be able to draw modules in from other places that are also open source. And actually along those lines, and reuse it. So this code base is actually being reused in Haiti right now as a resource directory for the Haitian government. The Haitian government has a special project for orphans and double orphans after the Haitian earthquake to provide services for them. And so crisis cleanup is the fundamental code base. The project is called Timon, T-I-M-O-U-N, which is Haitian Creole for child or children. And so that's also on GitHub. So the ability to repackage it and then use it for something completely different is, it's important to me. It's important to Andy Gimma.
So that's interesting. I was actually just about to ask, is this something that would only ever be hosted in one location in your organization as opposed to being refactored and reused? But you just answered that. Why doesn't something like the FEMA or one of the other government organizations pull this in the same way that Haiti has done then? Wouldn't that make coordination easier for them?
Yes, but it wouldn't work for a couple of reasons. Number one, the federal government, if you talk to a FEMA VAL, voluntary agencies liaison, and they're in charge of interacting with the voluntary space. Once FEMA gets involved, there are all kinds of regulations. They really can't have access to a lot of the client data. Now, it's minimal in terms of the personal information, but still, they really don't want it because it's very cumbersome for them. Number two is there is a level of distrust. I think it might be a little bit of an overstatement, but the voluntary space is independent from the government. Remember, the V in VOAD means you're not the boss of me. And I can tell you that if the voluntary space, if those voluntary organizations believed for a second that all of this information, all their client data was being provided to the government or to the insurance industry, that they would instantly stop using it and it would become worthless. So FEMA's participation would, in all practical terms, kill the project. So independence is extremely important for crisis cleanup, and it's something that I strive diligently to maintain. I'm not going after, I need funding, don't get me wrong, but I'm not going after government funding because it usually comes with strings attached.
It's probably also not just the independence, but also the transparency, because I can examine every line of source code that I'll be eventually interacting with. And if I'm really scared, I'll run my own instance of it for my organization. Has that ever happened that people wanted to just fork this and run it for themselves like that?
So it has been used in the Philippines. The International Organization on Migration has adopted it in the Philippines after Hurricane Typhoon Haiyan, and they used it for those efforts. As far as trust is concerned, I mean, I love it when people fork the code and start something new. There really isn't much of a need in the United States to do that, because if you just want to use it, and you know, here it is, and we'll do our best to maintain it and fix bugs, and most people like that.
Okay, and I have to get a little geeky in this show, or else people now email me and saying you didn't actually talk too much about the technology. So what's happening behind the scenes here? I bet some of it's in PHP, since that's at least your first language, as we discussed before the show. What projects are you reusing in this project and leveraging from?
So no PHP Yay. At all. Okay. So this is it's on the Google App Engine platform, which is we found to be powerful, highly idiosyncratic, and underdocumented. But you know, especially, man, SSL and Google App Engine is, I'd rather pull my own teeth than deal with that. So it's Python and heavy Ajax. You know, Python and JavaScript is really what it's written in. And on the Google App Engine platform, what we found when we interact with volunteers and people who want to get involved with the project, first, we just said, okay, well, you know, you gotta have Python, you gotta have JavaScript experience. And we found after a while that really what people need is Google App Engine experience because it is so idiosyncratic. I mean, I grew up on relational databases, and so I understand what a relational database is, and I understand tables and joins and foreign keys and all that stuff. Now, my undergrad is in, I have my BS in architecture and then my JD in BS. So my technology skills are mostly self-taught. And while I can do stuff and I've written websites, what would take me 4 hours to do, it would take, you know, a real programmer probably a half hour to do. So, but anyway, now that we're in the NoSQL world, I'm still trying to wrap my head around, you know, what that is. And the best way that it's been described to me is arrays of arrays, and like, okay, I understand what an array is, but still, just understanding the idiosyncrasies of NoSQL versus a relational database has been interesting for me personally.
So, how did you get hooked up with Adam? I believe that's his name, right? The chief programmer, Andy. Sorry, Andy. Too many A names today. Too many A names. I say them all to start with R. That'll be easier. I can do that. How did you hook up with Andy to get this started? Did you like sit over coffee somewhere and said, like, this is the kind of thing I want and can you help me with it? What was the process that led up to that?
So Andy was involved with the Hurricane Sandy relief efforts, mostly grassroots type activities. And it was a very natural fit. He was doing similar things, heard about my project. We got hooked up and we've been totally on the same page for the last 2 years, 2.5 years since Sandy, in terms of the goals, the objectives, the principles underlying crisis cleanup. And just having him on board has been an incredible, it wouldn't be a shadow of what it is without Andy.
Cool. And that sounds like a great partnership then. And continuing on, you have a number of other people working with you. Again, this is all just by accretion. People seem to find out about it and want to help.
Yeah. I do. I wrote a blog post about this because it got so frustrating sometimes. I get calls about once a week to once a month from somebody around the world, from Spain or from Italy or from somewhere in the U.S., saying some variation of let's work together. And my response to that is I will work with anybody who will work. Mm. Most people, though, when they say let's work together, what they really mean, you have like the project amoeba. Like, you have a project and I have a project. Let me take your project and subsume it in my project because I want to suck it dry like an orange. Or you'll have like the data leech. You have a lot of data. I don't know what your principles are or what you're doing, but your data is valuable to me. Why don't you spend a lot of money and dump all your data to me? I also get the shallow consultant. Hey, why don't you spend a lot of money in marketing dollars, giving me stuff so that I can go and promote it through my consulting business or something. And like, if you want to promote it, be my guest, but I don't make any money off of this. And then the other thing, like, you also get the bylaws breeders. It's like, let's make a super organization. I don't know what the super organization will do, but we could do amazing things. And I don't have any programming skills or money, but if I write bylaws, that feels like progress. So let's do that. And crisis cleanup, one minor correction. It isn't an organization. The last thing in the world I want to do is create yet another stinking NGO for the sake of having an NGO. I've created plenty of LLCs and things in my, you have to babysit them and feed them and clean up after them. And I just have no desire to do that. So we have a fiduciary agent, a fiscal agent, the New Jersey 2-1-1 Partnership. It has been a tremendous relationship with them. But Crisis Cleanup is a project, not an organization. And I don't intend to change that anytime soon if I can help it.
Awesome. And you just mentioned something I was going to ask next about. I had never seen the term 2-1-1 and had to Google for it to figure out what it was. Can you describe what that is for those of us that live on the West Coast and never heard of that?
Yeah, so 2-1-1 is a phone number designated by the FCC as a number you can call to connect with community resources. So you call 911 in emergencies, you call 411 for information. In some states, you call 511 for traffic. In New York, you call 311 to connect with government. And in many parts of the country, you call 211 to connect with community resources. This might be help with your taxes. It might be access to food stamps. And during a disaster in many states, 211s find themselves on the bleeding edge of people calling in just asking for help. They're the first ones to find out about it. So with Hurricane Irene, what happened was everybody called 211, and 211 would then make a database and then hand it off to a nonprofit. And then that nonprofit would be in charge of handing out, making assignments to go clean up Jane Smith's house and John and whoever else's house. Meanwhile, the people to whom they're making assignments are all VOADs, they're all voluntary. And remember, the V in VOAD means you're not the boss of me. And so there's sometimes with some friction there, like, hey, wait a second, what do you mean you're assigning me that? You're not in charge. You can't tell me what to do. And I don't have resources to do that. Then 2 weeks later, the people would call back up, call 211 and say, what's going on? Nobody's helped me. And so they would have to then play the telephone game and try to track down who was being helped and who got assigned what. And there was a massive breakdown in communication. And it ended up that 211 looked bad when they were just trying to help. So now with crisis cleanup and what we did with Sandy is 211 would take the calls directly, enter it directly into crisis cleanup, and then everybody can see what everybody else is doing. When the client calls back in 2 weeks, they can log in and say, well, it looks like the Baptists have claimed your work order. If you don't hear back from them in a couple of days, please call me back so I can engage in a little bit of collaborative accountability and help things along. Or they can simply say, look, it looks like nobody has claimed your work order. We're working as hard as we can. And you know, I'm sorry, we'll keep trying. But the point is that they now have real-time situational awareness that they never received before. And that was incredibly valuable for New Jersey 211. And so that's why the partnership has worked so well.
Now, I'm kind of a little confused now. If I'm a victim of a hurricane or a flood or something, I'm not going to crisis cleanup directly. I'm phoning 211, and the 211 people are the people who say when you're saying your work order, you're meaning the 211 people, right?
That's correct. Yes. If you are the victim of a flood, don't go to crisis cleanup. Go to the Red Cross. Go to the Volunteer Reception Center. Go to call 211. Go to your local church. And my goal with crisis cleanup is to support the wonderful work that they are doing and help them do it more efficiently so that they can help more people. I don't want to replace what they do. I can't replace what they do. I can't replace the Red Cross or, you know, a tenth of what they do or a millionth of what they do. But I'm here to support the wonderful organizations that are interacting directly with survivors and make their work more efficient. So you're correct. You would not go to crisiscleanup.org. You'd go to your local recovery organization and ask for help. Then they would use crisis cleanup to coordinate their efforts.
Awesome. Okay, I'm glad we got to clear that up then, because it sounded for a second like when you said your work order that meant the end user. No. Thanks for clearing that up. We're almost out of time, but I really also want to get to what your organization's needs are. Obviously, money and people, but can you narrow that down a little bit?
So on our about page, if you go to crisiscleanup.org/about, I'll get the question all the time, how much money do you need to tell crisis cleanup is done? And every time somebody asks that question, I think to myself, well, you really don't understand how software works. But I went ahead and on the about page, I put all of the things that we want to do. We want to create we want to finish our data model and then launch an API. And then, you know, we have a pretty strong history of developing under budget and on time. And so we've got a good idea of what these things will cost. And I went ahead and just put everything we want to do and how much it costs to do it. And here's what we need. So number one, that data model. Number two, an API. Once we do that, I want to create a customizable phone app that does not require internet access, so it's asynchronous, that can be branded anything that you want. So if you're the Baptist, I'll create a Baptist version of this. And so it's powered by Crisis Cleanup, but it's branded your organization so that you can coordinate in real time and put this in the hands of the volunteers in the field. Now, that's going to work wonders in terms of capturing volunteer hours, which everybody needs to know, and often there's money that local governments can get for those efforts. So I put all of that there. This is our development roadmap. And if you want to get involved, I would love to talk to you. I will work with anybody who will work. I've found, though, that if you can work for 2 weeks and that's about it, that's pretty exhausting. And I've got one of those pesky full-time jobs that I have to maintain, and my seventh child will arrive this month. So, if you're on, come on board. But the 2 week sprints, it takes almost that amount of time just to get you familiar with the code base and with the use cases. And then that's a short burn followed by a disappearance is not as helpful.
Awesome, awesome. And of course, if you have, you said Google app experience, that would also be very, very useful, at least in terms of helping with the code base.
Absolutely. Google App Engine, we found, is the what separates good programmers from great programmers with this project, or useful programmers, I should say.
There you go. Great. Hey, like I said, we're almost out of time. Is there anything we haven't covered that you want to make sure our audience is aware of before we have to let you go?
If you go to the front page of crisiscleanup.org, there is a video that will explains the use cases and the value propositions. The code base is on GitHub, GitHub/AaronTitus/crisiscleanup. Timon, which is derived from Crisis Cleanup, is on GitHub/AndyGimma/Timon, T-I-M-O-U-N. And so, please check out the code. Get in contact with me, Aaron, A-A-R-O-N, at crisiscleanup.org. You can contact us through the website about 20 different ways. So,
Would you also urge people who are volunteers for these various organizations to contact their coordinators ahead of a disaster to get used to the software and be able to move in more efficiently?
Definitely. I do a lot of outreach with voluntary organizations across the country. And so right now, for example, they're using it in Boston to help coordinate all of the snow cleanup efforts. And they're probably going to use it in the springtime because they're anticipating springtime floods due to the very high snowpack. Getting awareness ahead of time makes things a lot smoother. So please, contact your organizations. I'd be happy to do an introduction or a training or provide you with materials so that you can do that as well. And of course, if you click that donate button, that would be wonderful. But none of us are in the open source world because we're rich.
Aaron, this has been an awesome show. You're a noble man for having seen the need, and instead of just standing around going, I wish something was better, you actually made it better. So I want to thank you very much for that on behalf of all the people that you've helped out already, directly and indirectly and indirectly. Thank you very much for your efforts, and thanks for being on the show today.
Thank you very much for having me.
Very great, very great. That was Aaron Titus talking to us about Crisis Cleanup, a very remarkable way to use open source to solve real-world problems. What do you think, other Aaron?
Well, I mean, this is so great. I mean, I know that we didn't get too deep into technology today, but that's because this is just such a wonderful use of open source software to make a difference in the world. And it's such an interesting problem to solve for. I mean, once you kind of hear the concept, like the Craigslist concept, it's like, why didn't somebody think of this before? I mean, maybe just the fact that the technology wasn't there, the fact that you're not, thinking about this every day. Usually a lot of people only think about it when they hear about a disaster somewhere, right? And then they think about the problem, and then, and the other thing about this too is that it really does solve for that situation where, a lot of us, when a disaster happens, like if you think about all the disasters that have happened over the past few years or whatever, I mean, you're intensely, conscious of those and willing to help only for a limited time. There's got to be some graph somewhere that says, that charts people's willingness to help, and it starts off and then it goes down over time because you're just aware of it. I mean, we all have busy lives. You're aware of it right then. And it's important to capitalize on that from a volunteer standpoint. Because once that interest goes away, it's really hard to get that back. And so I think that any kind of tools, this one especially, it seems like it does a really good job that can capitalize on that and make things happen quicker and more efficiently, is really going to help. I mean, I mentioned the couple of times that I called various organizations to offer, whatever help I could. I mean, I'll be honest, I didn't call back a second time, right? I mean, I didn't keep calling. Right, because the things were happening, problems were getting solved, and it didn't look like there was probably a need for what I could do, but I don't know that, right? So I think that this kind of tool is really, really helpful, and I'm glad that open source was at least used and is beneficial in making it happen.
And I was just going to drive home that last point you made, which is that again, this is. I can't imagine something as effective as this appears to be, being done with Excel spreadsheets and DBase 2, and I'm dating myself, but all these things that are proprietary because it was open source. We were able to bring together not only talented volunteer programmers, but also just leverage on stand on the shoulders of people who had gone ahead of time and written things like Python and the Google App Engine and things like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And not only that, but it's interesting to think about this problem from this the standpoint of, you know, usually when we're developing programs or when we talk about projects, we're scratching an itch. And I guess in this case, you are scratching an itch, but it's the types of things that you think about in designing the software that runs this is a little bit different, right? You're not thinking about it necessarily from, you know, how cool can I make this or, you know, things like that, right? You're thinking about availability. You're thinking about, I need this software that's behind this application to be very stable and react well to outages and things like that. So you're just thinking about it from a completely different standpoint. So it's just interesting, even from that view, to think about what the differences are as you program this type of application with open source software versus, you know, other you know, graphics engines or, you know, other things like that.
Yeah, and also that you're designing this not in the sense of wanting to come up with the next cool thing that's going to make me $1 million, but rather I have a need to support other people, especially those who are where I can leverage that and support mm-hmm. people who are supporting people, as they are and said many times. It's interesting that that, you know, because this isn't about competition, it's also it doesn't have to compete in the other sense of it being, well, who you know, if there is something better than this, more power to them. We want this to be this problem to be solved by whoever can come along and do the best thing. But given that it's open source, people can take this and stand on, you know, on Aaron's shoulders and then his team's shoulders and do something even better, or enhance it and fold it back in. And so there's really there's no reason to have competition in this area, which is really interesting as well. Also, you touched on a point I want to mention as well. You know, it's one thing to design software that is, you know, that works, and but it's a whole different realm to design things that scale well and are robust. And I don't know if you got to this point. No, I don't think you did. Of user interface, this thing has to be used by people who have far less computer experience than we do. And how do you get that UX into that sort of thing? I haven't played. I only got a few moments to play with the demo, but it, you know, it's Ajax-y and things like that. So it's not, you know, this traditional web interface where you page load. Very nice stuff. So anything more on that before we move on?
No. I completely agree. I mean, just think about the since this is international, people are using different browsers. They're using different cell phones. They're interfacing with it in different ways. And so, again, just that need to be simplistic overrides the need to have a beautiful looking, you know, thing with lots of videos playing as you're interacting with it, right? That's not what they're going for here. So it's just a different design element as a programmer to try to design for something that's robust and highly available and used by many different people on many different technologies. As opposed to, and probably, you know, some old fallback technologies too. I mean, people might have to interact with that with because systems are going to be down and things. I mean, people are going to have to interact with this in ways that where they may have to revert to using some older technologies. So I'm assuming things like making sure that it's quick and speedy to use even on older PCs or older hardware, things like that. I mean, that's got to come into play too. So, you know, it's too bad we didn't have all the time in the world. We could have got to some of these questions because they all sound interesting, but it certainly is an interesting diversion for us to think about this type of program where your design considerations are probably a lot different than they would be normally.
Yeah, I'm sure the whole website isn't done in Flash, for example.
Right.
that would be hello, the 90s called. They want your application software back. Yes, great. Well, like I said, we could talk about this forever, but we're almost out of time. So I just want to make sure that we do the wrap-up stuff properly, which includes talking about the upcoming guests. We have next week on somebody I saw at Scale, which is one of the reasons I was at Scale, was to find new people to be on the show. This would be Stack Storm. It's a DevOps automation system, coordinates all the different alarms and signals that might go off from your all your different you know, Zabbix and other things that are sending alarms off, and then delivering them properly and having message buses that respond to that sort of stuff. I don't know too much about it except what I've read on the front page, so I'll leave that for our guest next week. A couple weeks later, we will have Mohid, which is a water modeling system. It's a you know, a physics engine that allows you to basically, here's where your water is coming down, and you put the pathway in, and it figures out where the water actually is going to be, and some live demonstrations I think are probably going to happen. We also have another special guest. You might not have seen too much of Randy Harper on this show recently. She's been sort of in job situations where it's difficult for her to get the time to actually co-host and stuff, but she has a very important project going on right now, and she's releasing some software, I think, today that will support this project. All I'm going to mention is the word Gamergate, and I will leave that for you to go Google if you haven't heard of it already. But Randy's going to come on in a couple weeks on the show and talk about what she's been doing with respect to the whole fiasco and all the crazy stuff that's going on. And she has some software to promote about that. So that's who we have on the short list. On the short list, we have Docker. They're still trying to get back to me to figure out a date for that. But if you want to see the rest of our guests and the lineup for that, you go to our homepage for this show, which is twit.tv/floss. And again, if you have guests you want to suggest that aren't on the big spreadsheet that's linked from there, please, please contact the project leader and they will contact me. That's how today's guest got on all in the last few days. So thank you to whoever suggested this to Aaron, because this is, it was an awesome show, and especially also helped because it filled the gap in my schedule. Great. Where you have a live chat room, we took a couple questions from there. That's at live.twit.tv while we're taping, which is typically 8:30 a.m. Pacific times on Wednesdays. I guess I should mention Wednesday, too, otherwise you're on the wrong day. You can follow me at Merlin, M-E-R-L-Y-N, on Twitter, and Google Plus, Randall L. Schwartz on Google Plus. And I was at Scale a couple weeks ago, and we've got a couple other people on the short list looking for slots on that. I will be in New York City in a couple of weeks. I'm having a meetup there. I'm just deciding which day it's going to be. I think it's probably going to be a Wednesday night, the first night I'm in town. But I will announce that on my Google Plus things, and next week, on next week's show, if I have it all nailed down. And I'm going to be at YAPSE North America. That's yet another Pearl Conference North America, which will be in Salt Lake City in early June. And so I will be there, again, looking for more guests. So I imagine there will be a few Pearl-related shows coming up right after I've been at YAPSE. Anything you want to plug there, Aaron, before we get going?
Yeah, lots of things. So hopefully people know I do a lot of other shows on the Twit Network as well. So you can catch me this afternoon on This Week in Google, where I'll be talking about all things googly, getting googly with it. So definitely check that out. And you know, I'll also try to put a reverse plug in for this show because it was so cool. I always like to do that as well.
Thank you. Yes.
But yeah, so check me out there. Also, you know, doing a lot of reviews for BYB. I just reviewed the Raspberry Pi Model 2, which I actually have in my backpack here. That'll be coming up shortly on BYB. I'm afraid I got a little bit too excited over the review, though, and I kept stumbling over my words because I was so excited about the Raspberry Pi Model 2. Most importantly, coming up on March 28th, if you're in the Bay Area, this is for the entire Bay Area, Benicia Mini Maker Faire is going on from 10 to 5 right here, or not right here, this is Petaluma, right there in Benicia, March 28th. And if you're into Maker Faires, making things, you just want to be inspired, or you have kids that like hands-on learning experiences, definitely make plans to come by. Buy your tickets early online, and you can find out more about that at BeniciaMakerFaire.com.
And with that, I'm starting to hear the music come up behind me, which, you know what that means. Means we'll see you again next time. In fact, next week on Floss Weekly.